I have some slides to show you. Here we go. In listening to the morning sessions, let me just say that the media have failed us terribly in explaining trade to the American people.
Yep, sure.
And the discussion of personal narratives is largely why. And it would be helpful for bipartisan reasons, which is my understanding of this forum, to think about why it is that trade is so consequential for the US. And it is interesting to note that trade has become the boogeyman of the 2016-2017 electoral cycle. And it is also worth noting that during the campaign, there was no light between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump on trade. None. So the question then is, how do you make trade work for the American people? Thought I'd show you a little bit of data. The top line is Canada. The bottom line is the United States. And this is each country's openness to global trade. What you can see in the Canadian line is that exports and imports over GDP are 66% versus the United States at 28%. The point to take from the slide is that the United States does not overwhelmingly depend on trade to grow wealth. That is a really important point to keep in mind. Take a look at China. China's at 40%, Chile at 60%. So the US is really an outlier in the scheme of things when it comes to dependence on trade to grow wealth. And it would be helpful if our politicians were not so quick to blame trade for all social ills in this country. What do Americans think of trade? A lot of talk this morning about repositioning certain issues and getting people to differently understand things post-Trump. The top line is those Americans who view trade as an opportunity. The bottom line in black is those Americans who think trade is a threat. Now, my hope in showing you this slide is that it's going to shock you. Because as you can see, nearly three quarters of Americans view trade as a good opportunity, not something to hide from. However, this horrible looking slide, courtesy of two Stanford PhD students, goes to the point that most Americans don't know anything about trade and don't especially feel overly jazzed about the subject matter. Now, to see what I'm talking about, if you look at don't know or only weakly oppose or support, you're talking about a supermajority of Americans. And what's really interesting is that when we think about who Bernie Sanders, Hillary Clinton, and Donald Trump were speaking to, they were really speaking to where my two arrows are. They were speaking to the outliers on the graph, their bases, who felt especially concerned about the subject matter. Trade, though, and please note, that subject matter is Medicare vouchers, and that subject matter is government regulations. Hard to imagine anything less interesting. But look at the delta there between how many people are indifferent to trade versus even those sublime issues. It goes to the point that there is no real sense for trade and what it means and what it does. And in fact, a lot of academic studies reveal that very few people are able to connect what trade means for their own pocketbook issues. In other words, they can't figure out whether their job should lend them to be in favor of more openness or in favor of more closure. Now, let's take a look at what's really going on, because trade has to be understood against a number of different issues. This is the Financial Times pointing out the obvious. Most American manufacturing jobs are being lost to technology, not to trade. And for those of you who want to see a real job killer, please look at your iPhone. Can you imagine how many jobs are being lost because of your iPhone? I still to this day find it amazing that any TV channel hires a weather person. I have 5 weather apps on my phone. I have constant feeds onto my watch from NOAA and NASA, and I still don't understand why I would wait until 11:22 every night to find out what the weather might be like tomorrow. Jobs. Now, to show you a concrete example, I want to share with you my favorite single example right now. What you're looking at is a robotic bricklayer. This is really a revolution. Your average sufficiently competent bricklayer lays 500 bricks a day. That robot lays 3,000 bricks a day, knows the exact temperature of the concrete being used, and has sensors so that it can detect exactly what the mix should be to make sure that the brick sticks. You want to see job loss? It's not trade. Not trade in any given rich country, that's for sure. It's technology. Here are the numbers. Job loss in the United States and wage suppression in the United States is 80% technology, maybe 11% trade. Please bear that in mind as our politicians promise us that the answer is to be more protectionist against China, et cetera. And when they do that, and remember that that number, 3,000 versus 500, please recall the Starbucks coffee that you purchased this morning. Your average cup of Starbucks coffee is sourced from 19 countries. Your ability to buy that cup of Starbucks coffee for $2.35, or if you're into the mochaccino, frappuccino, frap at 11:55, you're talking about 19 countries contributing to what it is that you're witnessing as a product that we all love dearly. Now, President Trump does not yet have any of his politicos appointed other than Wilbur Ross at Commerce. Lighthizer is being confirmed this week. But the administration nonetheless posted a document in which we were told a little bit about what his trade policy looks like, and needless to say, China got most of the attention. So I'm going to call this my China slide. And if you take a look at what he said, it's very misleading. If you look at the underlying terms, it's all about manufactured this, manufactured that, industrial goods, etc. And then you get hit with the big line that partisan and nonpartisan people all rehearse, that our trade deficit with China has ballooned to 355%. What they're not telling you, though, is also in the same document. What they're not telling you is that the United States, please soak this in, the United States currently has a massive trade surplus with China in services. In other words, banking, insurance, finance, consulting, legal, architecture, and research and development. The number is that since China joined the WTO in 2001, U.S. exports of services have increased 791%. Missed that number? That's okay. There it is. In other words, our exports to China in services, which is what 85% of Americans earn a paycheck doing. 85% of Americans earn a paycheck in a service sector. Those services are now exporting to China. We have surged almost 800% since 2001. This was the face of protectionism for those of you who, like me, remember an undergraduate class in economics where you had to deal with that. Fortunately, our students today don't have to deal with that because rich countries really don't use tariffs anymore. Rich countries use what Australia is using and what a whole bunch of other countries are using. They're using quality standards and labeling practices to completely shut down markets. And what you're seeing here is Australia's effort to do what's called country of origin labeling. Do you see the cute kangaroo hopping? Do you see the map of Australia and the two pie charts? Those are more complete in yellow or green, depending on what it's looking like. The more the product is sourced from Australia, watch this slide. That's the end of globalization right there. That is the single scariest weapon in today's global economy in terms of trade. In other words, this populist wave that may or may not be explaining Brexit and France's last vote, this is all over the world. That populism is called populism for a reason, but the scariest incarnation of it is that. That's Australia's country of origin. The United States just lost at the World Trade Organization doing exactly the same thing. 70 countries do this, and India is about to go to this measure in computer technology, where every single input will have to be labeled by country of origin. You won't have enough surface area on a notebook computer to get that done. Now, we have a big issue right now over preferential trade agreements. As you know, President Trump, in a blink of an eye, withdrew the United States from the Trans-Pacific Partnership and has a whole bunch of question marks on all future trade deals. The reason that's really important for Trump to get right is that the entire world is going in the direction of these trade deals. The way you read this map is the redder the country, the more preferential trade deals it has. Look at Singapore. You didn't realize you're coming to a geography exam, did you? Look at Chile. Look at Mexico. There are upwards of 40 free trade deals. What all these trade deals are is what's called WTO Plus. They're bigger, deeper, and more important in terms of opening market access than what the WTO does. Please don't listen to the rhetoric out of Washington. If the United States withdraws from NAFTA, first of all, we have a bilateral with Canada from 1989 that will go in effect. In other words, NAFTA is code for Mexico. Please also note that we don't revert to autarky, we revert to the WTO. So it's really important to understand what is and is not in play in what Trump has been saying. But again, Clinton would have said exactly the same thing, and after all, it's Bernie Sanders who told us that TPP was the worst deal of all time. Now, what you're looking at here is China's free trade deals. The way you read this map is China relates to every red country on a preference, China relates to every green country only under the WTO, and China relates to every gray country under no formal rules whatsoever. So what we have now is a three-tier global economy. Those who get a lot of preference, those who get no preference, and those who have no formal relationship to anybody, and yet those are a fading breed. Everyone right now is joining the WTO. Even Iran is in motion right now to join the WTO. This is Chile. That's what you're supposed to look like in 2017. All those red dots mean more business opportunities, more opportunities for our ranchers, our farmers, our laborers. That's the key. But the EU, when you hear people bemoan Brexit, that's Britain's problem. I'm not terribly concerned about whether the WTO and the EU will welcome Britain back with open arms. I'm more concerned with capacity on the part of Britain, which hasn't negotiated its own trade deal in forever, to get back all of those red dots. Can't do it. Cannot do it. Put it this way, the United States is the single largest trade bureaucracy on earth, and we're hard-pressed to simultaneously negotiate two trade deals. How does Britain do that? Answer is it doesn't. Here's the US. This is one boring map. There are no big economic prizes there. That's why we needed TPP. That's why we need the free trade deal with the European Union. Apparently, Merkel was sufficiently convincing. Trump now understands we can't just do a trade deal with Germany. We have to do a trade deal with the entire EU. The good news is the trade deal's already written. It's called the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. It's going to come in one form or another. It may come first as a US-UK free trade deal, but one day it will get done, and it is the best language the United States has in terms of legal writings on the books today. Now, we got out of this deal. Trump pulled us out of this, and by the way, he did it in two paragraphs sent to New Zealand. Talk about blink of an eye. Now, those are the countries that were going to join TPP, and what Trump is going to tell people is, well, we didn't really need TPP because we already had bilaterals with all those countries. So the big pickup was Japan. We will do a free trade deal with Japan. That's our fourth largest trade partner. After that, you follow the number 24 with Malaysia. So Japan's the big pickup. We will move on Japan, but what was really important about TPP was that it was an upgrade for all these old trade deals that we have. We have trade deals like NAFTA from 1994 or Peru from 2009 or a whole bunch of our deals from 2004. These are all out of date. We need to revamp them. We need better legal architecture to get the job done. TPP would have done that. The single best thing about TPP was that it was an upgrade. The second best thing about TPP is it gave us bilateral investment treaties with all of these countries, and we don't have any with any of these developing countries. Now, why bash TPP and get out of it so fast? Again, going back to my earlier point, most Americans have no conception of what trade is, and a stunning 70% had never heard of Trans-Pacific Partnership. So the big mystery should be, why is it that all of our candidates in the 2016 cycle were so adamantly opposed to TPP? Let me give you my theory. It's easier to run against trade than to run against technology. The beauty is that trade has a face and a flag. Technology doesn't. And no one can run against your iPhone. But please don't let them get away with it. We desperately need these trade deals, and we desperately need trade. Remember the number, 95% of the world's consumers live outside the United States. 88% of the world's purchasing power parity lies outside the United States. Even the reluctant trader, President Obama, said you can't just pull up the drawbridge and hide behind the moat. We can't do it. This is the deal that we need. I hope it's going to come about. It'd be nice if the media would start covering this a little better. It'd be nice if the media bothered to get beyond the personal narrative and actually learn a little bit about trade. But they're not, and I think that the sessions that you heard this morning are evidence as to why that's true. Here's the word that you're allowed to say in polite company about trade, and I'll end with this. You're allowed to talk about enforcement. And Trump is going to tell you a lot about enforcement in the months and years to come. I want to show you that you have nothing to worry about on enforcement. This is the US litigation map. You see the red? Those are all the countries we're suing. You see the blue? Those are all the countries suing the United States. Sorry, this is China. This is the US. So if we go through, you take a look at China, very little litigation against anybody. And then you take a look at the United States, we sue everybody. We are on the verge of 600 WTO disputes. The United States is involved in 100% of those cases. So you have nothing to worry about in terms of enforcement. No one is cheating the United States. No one knows that better than the United States. Rest assured, for all that happens in the partisan world of the media, the professional bureaucracy in Washington, D.C. is actually incredibly smart and willing to work across the aisle, as I know Patricia would like this group to do as well. So I'll conclude with this. For all that you're about to hear about trade, and for all that you may deep down feel about trade, we have no choice. We have to do it. Let's write really good rules and let's enforce them. And let's remember what President Obama told us. You can't pull up that drawbridge. This is the single greatest advantage to living here in the United States. We have one of three bureaucracies that understands every facet of the global economy. Let them do their job. Because while the politicians can't get it right across the aisle, the bureaucrats can. Let them do their job. Thank you.